From its beginnings in the 17th century, American higher education has had a somewhat uneasy and self-conscious relationship with the world beyond the academy. Terms like real world and ivory tower have been invoked by critics to suggest pejorative views of the academy as removed, idyllic, self-serving, a place where internal priorities and politics bear little relationship with the day-to-day concerns of essential public interests. When Congress passed the Morrill Act in 1862, it established land-grant schools that were intended to be, in the words of Abraham Lincoln, the public's universities. The Morrill Act showed a way forward for all of higher education in two primary ways. One, promoting wider access, and two, delivering a curriculum that built on colonial priorities of the classics and preparing learned professional men to include the practical arts and sciences, education for diverse careers, and an expanded mission of service to society. In the modern era, curriculums in most American colleges and universities moved toward amalgams of liberal education, the practical arts and sciences, and professional preparation. More recently, as human society has become increasingly global and interdependent, higher education's relationship to the public good has again become a compelling concern. In 2000, the Kellogg Commission on the Future of State and Land-Grant Universities called for universities to renew their covenant with the American people and to become more productively involved with communities, however those respective communities might be defined. A cursory tour of current websites reveals that public and private schools alike are highlighting institutional commitments to civic and community engagement as an important facet of their missions. Increasing numbers of music schools and departments are doing likewise, in some cases with the support of major funding. And institutions are creating both university-level and departmental positions to shepherd this function. Though sometimes criticized as an effort to curry political and philanthropic favor, evidence suggests that the movement is driven by a deep sense of responsibility for the common good. Many students and faculty are seeking learning cultures that resonate with their inherent desires to be actively and positively engaged with the world beyond the academy. They are pursuing this learning in symbiosis both with their career preparation and with the wider and complementary spheres that comprise the totality of their lives. Indeed, issues of relevance, values, and ethics driven by concern for the public good are at the forefront of contemporary debate in governmental, corporate, and nonprofit sectors beyond the university. Several months after the 2008 collapse of Lehman Brothers, for example, Joel Padolny, former dean of the Yale School of Management, wrote that business schools provide students with many technical skills, but they appear to do little or nothing to foster responsibility and accountability. Students are convinced that nitty-gritty work can be done without consciously considering factors such as values and ethics. Business schools must demonstrate a greater affinity with society's interests. According to CNNMoney.com, Padolny, who completely revised Yale's MBA curriculum, has the big idea that business schools ought to teach real-life problem-solving. Increasingly, music graduates who achieve positions in major or regional orchestras or opera houses, both here and abroad, or in related apprentice programs, are expected, if not required, to participate in community engagement. These programs are embracing a far broader spectrum of mutually determined social, artistic, and educational interests than historic one-way, one-off, missionary-style outreach and education efforts. And freelance musicians are finding that grant applications require evidence of ways in which their musical work benefits a wider goal of community well-being. On becoming Secretary of Health, Education, and Welfare in the 1960s, John Gardner, former head of the Carnegie Foundation, spoke of breathless opportunities masquerading as insoluble problems. If we in higher music learning miss this breathless opportunity to align the preparation of 21st century musicians with this cross-sectoral, international movement for the public good, we truly risk validating accusations of irrelevance. Inevitably, some will charge that such a broadened perspective may represent dumbing down the curriculum. I concur with those who, by contrast, aver that what is really at work is a long overdue wising up to important realities about the future of music and musicians, perhaps even music schools in society. Andrew Hacker and Claudia Dreyfus, authors of a recent provocative analysis of higher education, observe that professors are often isolated not only from those outside their disciplines, but also from the outside world. After taking aim at everything from escalating tuition to overpaid star professors, tenure, and navel-gazing faculty who teach only their own research without regard for the needs of students, Hacker and Dreyfus make a simple suggestion for improvement. Those who choose higher education as a profession ought to view it as a public service. We want young people to use their minds as they never have before, they say, thinking hard about realities and issues that strain their mental powers. They should be urged to be imaginative and inquiring, to take risks without having to worry about their transcripts or alienating their teachers. As one example, they describe a two-semester sociology and criminology program entitled Community Organizing and Community Action. In the first term, the students read Saul Alinsky and Stanley Aronowitz. In the second, they go out and organize a tenants' union. Now, Hacker and Dreyfus are not right-wing thinkers. If you read The Economist, you may be familiar with the Schumpeter column, named in honor of the brilliant 20th century Austrian economist Joseph Schumpeter, who is credited with popularizing the term entrepreneurship. The September 4th column notes that Hacker's and Dreyfus's liberally oriented criticisms surprisingly align with those of two conservative think tanks, the American Enterprise Institute and the Goldwater Institute. Considering these criticisms as a whole, the column poses this ominous question. I spent some time reflecting as a music faculty member and administrator on one of Hacker's and Dreyfus's more pointed criticisms, one that echoes Joel Padolny's charge about business schools. The criticism is that too much higher education is little more than technical level vocational training. Relieved that they didn't mention music schools, I initially took solace in the fact that majoring in music is often viewed as an avenue of fulfillment for talented persons who seek to pursue their passions for music through higher learning. Within this widely circumscribed and supremely innocuous vision, we have strived to nurture knowledge and skill to support the option of earning a sustainable, or perhaps a partially sustainable, living in and through music. In most cases, this has meant some assumed composite of teaching, performing, and perhaps conducting and composing. However, one prestigious American university honestly acknowledges on its website that many of its music majors do not go on to careers in music, but use the major as a last opportunity to engage in musical studies before plunging into demanding careers, such as law, business, and medicine, that leave little or no time for music. Sad, isn't it? My reflective process reminded me that our current predilection for advocacy may well lead us to latch on to arguments for the socioeconomic importance of the arts, such as Richard Florida's creative economy ideas and Daniel Pink's assertion that creative empathizers will have a competitive economic edge in the 21st century. Nevertheless, music schools are not typically inclined toward extolling financial advantages as a benefit of earning a music degree. On further thought, I realized that neither are we inclined as faculty to engage actively with public policy affecting the arts. Moreover, it would be difficult to argue that we are universally committed to a circumspect, consistent, and well-articulated vision of music and musicians in 21st century society. At this point, I recalled the words of Henry Fogel in his speech to the National Association of Schools of Music last November. Henry posed this question: are we preparing music students to go forward in this world and help to shape the America of the 21st century? Now, the problem with reflective thinking is that it leads you places you didn't know you were going, and perhaps didn't want to go. Sometimes into a messy swamp rather than speeding along a multi-lane expressway. I found myself confronting a discomforting conundrum. Despite the emphasis music schools place on the accrual of technical skill and knowledge in music performance, creation, and scholarship, there is an historic and epic absence of realistic career talk. I'm not talking here about job talk. I'm talking about career talk. Talk that is based on a dynamic convergence of music as public value and the capacities of graduates to forge sustainable career pathways in tandem with advancing the place of music and musicians in society. We know very well that a music degree is not a prerequisite for singing on the Met stage, or conducting the Cleveland Orchestra, or even, as it is in many fields, teaching in higher education. As one doctoral conducting student is said to have inquired of his mentor, "Why do I need a degree? Zubin Mehta doesn't have one." To which the mentor is said to have replied, "That, son, is precisely why you do need a degree." It's hardly a secret that the vast majority of performance, composition, theory, and musicology graduates will be teachers. Yet how is this fact manifest in our curriculums? Through rigorous guided teaching internships? Systematic graduate assistant mentoring? By requiring our students to think seriously about issues of learning and teaching and their identities as artists, scholar, teachers? By urging them to consider their roles in a larger context of responsibility for the musical well-being of their communities? Perhaps in some places. But generally speaking, higher music learning emphasizes singular absorption in ever higher levels of technical mastery, to the near exclusion of any consideration of the diverse settings and audiences where that technical understanding might potentially be applied. Depth in one's discipline, of course, is essential. And self-absorption may be tolerable among superstar scholars and performers, though many of today's superstars are smartly realizing the importance of connecting more meaningfully with their audiences. But unbridled self-absorption becomes a severe handicap and a potential recipe for lifelong victimization and angst among those who might otherwise realize fulfilling careers by embracing teaching and public service. Twyla Tharp wrote in her book, The Creative Habit, about the longed-for lucky break that characterizes the self-absorbed desire that we will become recognized for our artistry, our scholarship, our teaching. Tharp said, if you want to be lucky, be generous. If you're generous to someone, if you do something to help him or her out, you are in effect making that person lucky. She said, whenever I feel I'm working in a groove, it's invariably because I feel I am being the benefactor in the situation rather than the beneficiary. In the case of music, the problem may be less that we've been overtly vocational and more that technical training has too often been an end in itself, the products of which have historically been left to graduating students to determine on their own terms or on the basis of their own luck. As University of Rochester President Rush Rees declared on the founding of the Eastman School in 1921, educated musicians should be much more than expert musical technicians. We thus find ourselves at a critical juncture as to whether a curricular model and assumptions that evolved concurrently with a desire to advance classical music in the 20th century will be sufficient for the challenges of a very different musical world in the 21st century.